This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do. All you want to do is ride around
Saturday. Ride, Saturday, ride. The press release says it is a magical encounter between horse and man. It is called Cavalia. And if you have a chance to see it, jump on it. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb for The Horse Show. Because of my rather extensive connections within the horse industry, I was invited to be part of the audience for the opening night of Cavalia in Scottsdale, Arizona, and I was astounded by what I saw and very eager to talk to the folks behind it. So that's what you'll hear today, the co-founder of Cirque du Soleil. Remember that? How it kind of redefined the whole idea of a circus? He went on and created Cavalia. His name is Normand Latourelle. And I'll be talking to him a little bit later in the program, followed by a chat with the co-head horse trainer, the star of the show, along with his wife. His name is Frederic Pignon, and her name is Magalie Delgado. I'll be talking to Frederic about his point of view on this whole thing, what it's like from a performance standpoint, from a horsemanship standpoint. And I have to tell you, this is some of the most magnificent horsemanship I have ever seen. And I had been hearing this about this production from my good friend and co-author Bob Miller, who had seen it several times over in California. And he was absolutely right. It's astounding. And the logistical challenge of putting on a show like this is another thing altogether. And we'll get a sense of that when we talk to Normand in just a little bit. But first off, we're going to talk to my old buddy Len Brown, the genius, but I don't tell him that very often, but the genius behind the original Ortho-Flex saddle. He no longer owns the company, but he's still obsessed with the idea of making saddles fit horses better. And he's come up with a thing called the CorrecTOR pad, which is not a saddle pad. It's a dynamic pressure distribution appliance. That's what he calls it. Very inexpensive, less than the cost of most good saddle pads. But he claims it will make any saddle fit any horse or mule. And we'll talk to him in depth about that in just a few moments. I want to remind you folks about my television show on RFD-TV. And a lot of you are already watching it. But in case you're not, it's called, take a guess, The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. That's right. On television, on RFD-TV, anybody who has Dish or Direct satellite subscription service has access to RFD-TV. And an increasing number of cable systems are also offering it. And I know it's a little frustrating to some of you who have cable that you can't get RFD-TV yet. But that is changing, and it does help if you request it from your cable provider. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back.
EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same-day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention The Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention The Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Red Brand Fence welcomes you to visit our new online store called redbrandstore.com. There you can purchase Red Brand Fence, installation tools, and a wide selection of Red Brand clothing and accessories. Ordering is easy, and items are shipped directly to your home, including fence. There's also special offers and seasonal promotions. And for a limited time, listeners of The Horse Show can receive 10% off your first order of fence, clothing, or tools. To receive your discount, go to redbrandstore.com and enter promo code HORSESHOW10.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's G-R-O-strong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Imagine this, your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with a lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com, and while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Well, it is an age-old problem, people. I'm talking about the issue of saddle fit, how to make a saddle fit a horse comfortably and still be comfortable for the rider. My guest today was a pioneer years ago. In fact, in 1985, he got the horse industry thinking about the whole issue of saddle fit when he introduced the Ortho-Flex saddle. He's back again with something equally innovative, in my opinion, and very, very different. We're going to talk about that today with my guest, Len Brown. Len, welcome back to the Horse Show.
Thank you, Rick.
Now, how does a creative guy, let me just talk to you for a moment about the creative process. You are an inventor, a confirmed inventor. I don't think you could stop inventing.
I have a lot of patents, yes.
You've got a lot of patents, you're driven to do this. Where does that creative spark come from in a guy like you?
Finding a need in the marketplace is part of it. When there's something that doesn't work and you have to make something to satisfy your own needs, this is how most inventors come about inventing anything.
Well, and you, going back now, you did a cross-country ride on the back of a horse that was kind of an eye-opener for you, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. It was a 3,000-mile through the West with pack horses, living outdoors trip in 1982.
Yeah. And then it was an outgrowth of that, I presume, that you created the Ortho-Flex and brought that to market.
That's right.
Now, just to bring everybody up to date, Len sold the Ortho-Flex company a few years back. Len, you chose to get out of the business of making that kind of a saddle. Why did you do that?
Well, it was swimming upstream, and the further upstream you get, you know, the faster and the harder the current is.
Now, are you talking about public acceptance of the idea, or was there something else?
Most definitely, public acceptance being the major part, Rick. And it's one thing to take on a product line. It's another thing to take on an industry. I didn't want to be in that position anymore.
Now, on your website currently that talks about your new product, you say that you feel that that system, in retrospect, will never work quite as well as you had hoped it would. What did you mean by that?
As far as the Ortho-Flex itself, as I tell customers, if it isn't broke, don't fix it. But there are things that limit every engineering accomplishment. Nothing is perfect. With the Ortho-Flex, the panel system worked quite well, but it isolated the riders from the horse. They didn't like the feel. This often happened. Number two thing is that because the tree no longer came up against the horse's shoulders in the stop or in the downhill, its capabilities to slide up way too far forward were really significant. So this is one of the limitations of Ortho-Flex. It's hard to get it where it should be and keep it there, is putting it in a nutshell.
But as you say, if somebody is using that type of a saddle today and it's working for them, hey, more power to them.
That's right.
So you went about, as you told me off the air, you kind of had to clear the brain out and get a little bit outside of yourself, think outside the box, as the expression goes, to come up with a whole new approach to saddle fit. And what you came up with was not a saddle at all. Tell me about it.
That's true. And I did realize that we create our own box, even though we like to think that we're outside that box. And in really assessing what I could do to solve the basic problem, and that was the mission of making horses more comfortable and fixing the saddling problems out there. The Ortho-Flex was not a complete saddle. It was a system that attached to a saddle. And with all the experience I had through the years, I sat and thought about what I could do to accomplish the same thing without coming up with a complete saddle.
Let me interject something there, because I don't want to confuse people. The Ortho-Flex was sold as a saddle, but the flexible panel system could be retrofitted to any saddle.
That's true.
Okay, now go ahead.
And what I essentially did was to try to come up with a product which is used on the horse. This is not really a pad. There is no padding to it. It's not much over a quarter of an inch thick. But it is also trying to alleviate the pressures that take place under a normal saddle, whether English or Western.
What do you call the product?
It's called the CorrecTOR.
So the CorrecTOR is not a saddle pad, but it would be used in place of a saddle pad or in addition to a saddle pad?
Which? Used right on the horse, and then you put your saddle pad on, you put your old saddle on, and this becomes a tremendous equalizer, as you could call it, as far as saddles go, because all of a sudden you can take a saddle that normally couldn't be used on a horse at all, or mule, and make it work extremely well for the animal.
Now, I was trying to explain this to somebody one time, and using some of your verbiage off of your website, what I came up with was I called it a dynamic pressure distribution appliance. How do you like that? Is that fairly close?
I think you should be in engineering, Rick.
or marketing, anyway. So the point is that this device can distribute pressure out throughout it to sort of equalize places where there are pressure points with a saddle. How does it do that?
Well, having built my own saddle tree company and all the patterns for anything Ortho-Flex was ever built on, I made those shapes. In doing this and riding the horse on trees, bare trees, seeing what the problems were, I knew where the main problems are under a saddle. And then you have to know how the horse's body functions while he's being ridden, not while he's standing on the ground, not how he looks while he's standing. So in the term fit that you used earlier, if you take that out of your vocabulary when you're talking about saddles and horses and inject the word work, what I want to do is not make a saddle fit a horse, because he's moving, he's changing. We can't really use that term, but we can use the term work. So in doing this, four points are your major problems, two in the front, two in the rear. In the saddle tree, and impinging upon movement with the horse. That's what I developed to try to solve.
My guest is Len Brown, inventor of the CorrecTOR pad for making saddles fit horses. When we get back, we'll talk about the two most common saddle fit problems, bridging and rocking. This is The Horse Show. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. Six panels make a 13-foot round pin, eight panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter in, corrals.com.
Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the five very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com.
Hello, I'm Leslie Nielsen, and you're listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. Remember, a wet bird never flies at night.
I have no idea what that means, but it always makes me laugh. I'm talking with Len Brown, inventor of the CorrecTOR pad, a dynamic pressure distribution appliance. Len, let's go back to the point you were making there between the words fit and work. I would summarize that by saying perfect saddle fit, which was kind of what everybody was pursuing there, is an impossible dream. You've got something that is a rigid surface having to fit, quote-unquote, against a constantly moving dynamic surface, which is the horse's back. That you're doomed from the beginning. Logic tells you that that can never really work. And so, didn't mean to use your word work, but the idea, as I understand it, which I think is a brilliant point, is we're just trying to make the saddle fit good enough or well enough to do the job, to work.
To work. That's what it narrows down to. It isn't a new problem. This has been a problem for hundreds of years because I've studied the oldest of patents.
Now, when you look at this thing, and you've got some great photographs of it on the website, and we'll be sure and give that out before we're done here, but when you look at this thing, you see that it's got these sort of little windows almost, about this. It looks like they're about the size of a nickel or a quarter or something like that, in kind of a circular pattern on these four corners of the device. What is happening in those?
Those are simply little ventilation holes on the top layer of the corrector. They're 3/4 inch around. They're open above every slot in the molded shields that are in the corrector. There are two shields in the front, molded to the shape of a horse where we want them to work from. There are two shields in the rear. And there are 112 running inches of slots in these four little shields. The holes that you see there, there's about 38 of them, I think, are giving ventilation capabilities. I don't say breathe, as you note. It allows for that heat to rise up and through the unit so that you don't create too much of a hothouse against the horse.
The two typical fit problems, correct me if I'm wrong on this, are bridging and rocking, correct?
And that's the two opposites of end of the spectrum.
Right, and of course, the point you're making being there could be any number of issues that fell somewhere in between. How does your device deal, for instance, with a saddle that bridges?
Bridging typically only takes place, Rick, when the horse's back is tensed. When the back muscle, the longissimus dorsi, contracts, segmented muscle on each side of the spine, it hollows the back. So the back pulls down and it drops in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a little pain in the front, it's a natural reaction to tense your back if you have pain up on your neck or your shoulders. And the same with a horse. The same happens in the loin area. So if you don't have the prodding or poking in the loin area, if you don't have the pinching in the wither area, then the back of the horse comes up 1 inch minimum at a walk carrying a rider. It comes up 1.5 inches and more at a trot.
Even a horse that hasn't been trained to raise his back, to elevate his back, you're saying that that'll just happen automatically?
Absolutely.
What about a saddle that rocks?
Rocking is where somebody has tried to fit a saddle to this horse that's standing still, and his back is what? It's relaxed, so it is dropped again in the middle. When they fit to that and then have the ends of the tree flared so that they don't dig in and they have contact in the middle, when the horse starts to move and his back comes up, then the saddle has propensity to rock, per se. This is a problem very common with mules because their backs are so straight.
Yeah, because they've allowed too much in the front and the back, too much clearance there. And
for a horse shape and a horse saddle, you put it on a mule, this is something you have. I make a fix for that with a corrector called balance shims that go on top of these little shields, and they just Velcro in place.
What are the shields actually made of? What is that material?
The shields are made out of a plastic that is formed by heat in a mold. It's very durable. I've used it for 16 years. Some of them are still out there working.
Mm-hmm.
Not the corrector itself, mind you, but this type of polymer.
What is the corrector itself, the pad part of it, made out of?
It's polyester felt, which is a fairly open weave blend on the bottom so that it is not extremely hard. It's relatively soft. Then a thin layer of a polyester felt that has a nylon cloth formed inside it for strength, because the corrector's cut completely open down the middle.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't look open in a picture, but it's on the mold of a horse's back in that picture.
Mm-hmm.
If it wasn't cut open, it couldn't accept the shape of that horse's back.
Now, is there any horse or mule that this would not help with?
None that we have found so far.
So most of the horses...
I tested it on some very different animals.
Okay, so most of the horses that our audience would be likely to have, this would probably help them. What about existing saddles? We got Western saddles, we've got jumping saddles, dressage saddles. How does it work for those different kinds of saddles?
Right now it's being used under all of them.
So you've got people out testing this then?
I've got people that have bought it that are more than testing it. They're using it. They are my test pilots, so to speak. That's why I keep in contact with my customers.
Give our audience an idea of what this sells for.
The standard Western version sells for $150, Rick.
$150, so that's less than a lot of good pads sell for.
I've kept the price as low as possible, and I'm marking it direct, mostly through the internet and the website. And by doing that and keeping everything small, you don't have the overhead to have to factor in.
I know you've been there and done that.
I've been there and got very big in overhead.
Yeah. Why don't you give folks your web address and we'll send them right there.
It is CorrecTOR, CorrecTOR.net.
.net, not .com, folks, but .net, thecorrector.net. My guest has been Len Brown, genius, I suppose.
You're making me blush.
That I wish I could see. Len, thanks for being with us today.
Thank you a lot.
Still to come, Cavalia, a magical encounter between horse and man, kind of like Cirque du Soleil with horses. We'll meet the man responsible for both, Normand Latourelle, when the horse show continues. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. Hey, everybody. Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order.
Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Cavalia. Some of you have probably heard of it or have seen it. I'm sitting here with the managing director. I'm not sure even what your title is.
The crazy guy.
The crazy guy in charge of all of this, Normand Latourelle. Am I saying it correctly?
Yeah, the name is good, yeah.
Thank you so much for joining us today. For somebody who is not familiar with Cavalia, how would you describe it?
Well, actually, it's very difficult to describe because it's something you've never seen anywhere before. The show is about horses. We tell the story of the relationship between men and horses. But in order to do that, we have 40 horses, we have 40 artists, huge, big top tent, and we have created a show where you get to see acrobatic dance, a lot of multimedia, special effects, and horses. Half of the horses come on stage completely free. Equestrian technique become equestrian arts, and a lot of lights. I have decided one day to use the most modern technology to support the oldest technology, which are the horses. But the most modern technology is what we have today, has special effects and lights. And
Oh yeah, and it is spectacular. The scene changes continually, virtually throughout the performance. It's hard to imagine how you can make each of the scenes or the sets seem so different, and yet we know that it's the same basic elements. Is that through lighting?
That's through projection. We have a very sophisticated multimedia projector system. The projector are used not like a rock and roll show. They are used to create a location, to bring the crowds to a different atmosphere, also to different space, to a different part of the season. We use a lot of the season, and the projector are used to create images, and the images is the set. So we have a virtual set based on a screen which is 210 feet wide, which is 3 times a screen of a movie theater, so it's huge.
And it's even transparent at times, isn't it, through the way you light it? Because you can sometimes see people on the other side of it, intending it to be seen that way, obviously, just through the way the lighting is, and other times it appears to be solid.
Yeah, I like to play with layers, so as far as the show goes on, the public discover different layers, so you don't get to see the background totally before very far in the show, and we have what I consider four different layers. You have the front stage. The stage is very wide, it's 160 feet wide, but you have the front stage, you have the mid stage, you have the what I call the little hill, and you have the backstage. And you get to see all of that at the end of the show, where you discover that fabulous set, because it's so huge, so big, even if it's in the touring tent. The set was conceived to fit the horse. If you take a regular acrobat, a horse is 10 times bigger than a regular acrobat, so we have to create a set which is almost 10 times bigger than a regular set.
What I noticed about the sets was that they changed so quickly. You just were transported into a different place and different time, and you couldn't figure out how that... It's like watching a magician. You know what you saw, and you don't believe that that was possible. But that's how the set struck me. You have a background in unusual productions. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, I always wanted to do something different. So my background is to research, but I always try to reach the public, to touch their heart. So I don't have an approach, a very intellectual approach. I have a more spectacular approach. One of the guys was part of the beginning of Cirque du Soleil back in the 80s. So I helped to start and to begin Cirque du Soleil. And at that time, when people were asking me what was Cirque du Soleil, I could barely say what it was, because I was, you know, telling them that it was a circus, but it was not a circus, because at that time we had no animal. Still, Cirque du Soleil has no animal, but in 1980s, a circus with no animal, it was not a circus, it was something else. So I had to say, at that time I had to explain that it was a circus, but has more acrobatic dance and very artistic. So all of that, taking so many words to explain what Cirque du Soleil was, meant to me that we had reinvent something, or we have an invention, and it's the same thing with Cavalia. After, when I left Cirque, that's back in 90s, I concentrated myself into multimedia, because I thought the multimedia was the new way of telling the arts. It was the new approach. And now I combine the multimedia with the horse, which is for me a total discovery, because I was not a horse person at all.
Have you learned a lot doing this and just being exposed to all of these horses all the time?
Of course. Not only exposed to horses, but what I learned most is what Frederic Pignon and Magali Delgado are telling me all the time. They are the one who know the horses. And they are a great teacher, because the way they... I was very hesitating of doing a show with animals. I didn't want to do a show with taking advantage of the animals. So it took me a lot of years of research before getting and finding Frederic Pignon and Magali Delgado. And when I saw what they were doing, and when I saw their work, and especially their relationship with the horses, it was so good for the animals, I thought, well, maybe this is a good way to approach a show with animals, which are the horses. And then I learned a lot about the horses, and they are domesticated animals. Of course, I have a dog at home, I don't have a horse. But for me, when I saw Frederic working with his big dogs, I said, well, this is a way where we can do something very spectacular, but at the same level of the respect, because this show is about respect. It's about very good relationship with the horses and the people.
It creates a very emotional reaction, I think, with your audience. At least it did the night that I saw it, which was the opening night here in Scottsdale. Is that a typical reaction from your audience?
Every time I do a show, I want to touch the people. For me, it's the basic. I want to be emotional. And the, you know, when you bring a horse completely bare on the stage, he doesn't need to have a costume, which is the first thing I realized by working with horses. They are just fabulous animal. So if you put them in a good relationship with the people, and the people are treating the horses by respect, then you have a perfect, and this is no tricks, it's just the way they are, both, and the respect they have to each other, because they respect the horse, respect the trainer, and the trainer respect the horse. And you get to see that on stage. So this is where you get touched, because you you look what's going on for your in front of your very eyes, and you just realize this is magic. This is very emotional.
How do you deal with the variability of the horse every night?
Yeah, there was a big technical challenge here because, of course, when you speak about multimedia, you start to speak about very sophisticated machines and cues. And when you speak about acrobatic, you also speak about cues and music. All of that has to be planned. So we have changed the way of doing shows. When you see Cirque show, there's a lot of mechanic involved. Here, the mechanic is controlled by the human. Of course, we do have the mechanic, but every cue goes one by one. There's always a person behind the machine. So it's the person who tells the machine where to go and where not to go. The musicians are able to see the show and they follow the horses. So everybody, and sometimes I look after a show, I look at the timing, and the first half, sometimes it's 50 minutes, sometimes it's 54 minutes, and it's the same thing for the second half, from 55 to 65 minutes. So it varies a lot.
So for those extra 10 minutes, your crew is improvising, basically.
Certainly the one on the stage, we just play more music, but of course the music is written. I mean, we play the same team. You know what I learned about horses, and that's absolutely fabulous, is they don't care about time. When you go to rehearsal with horse, it's not like an acrobat. The acrobat, you say, okay, we're going to start at 9 o'clock this morning, and we have a break at 10:30, and we have a lunch at noon. The horse, and then you work with the acrobats for 3-4 hours. The horse, when they are bored, they just turn around and say, I want to go back to my box.
That's it, I'm done. What is the most difficult part of your job? And the flip side of that question, what is your favorite part of your job?
That's a very good question. The logistic of this tour is the most difficult one I ever seen. I mean, traveling with 40 horses, with so many equipment, because the tent is one of the biggest touring tent in North America. This is the difficult part. The logistic is very, very difficult. Like, it's not a, I mean, we have 40 semi-trailer on the road.
Did you say 40, 4-0?
Yes, we have 40, 4-0. And also we bring 2,500 tons of sand, which represent almost 75 dump truck of sands in every city. So the logistic is absolutely fabulous.
Well, and when someone walks in, they have an immediate sense of how difficult that must be to pull that off. What is your favorite part of this job?
It's after every show when I see the people standing up instantly. It will always be my favorite moment of this. This is the greatest life, you know, as a creator. What can you have more when you have 2,000 people after every show standing up and say, well, I love that, you know.
What's next for Norman?
Well, I already started to think about that. And for me, when I create a show or a concept, I start with small piece of puzzle and it become, you know, thousands puzzle piece, and then I put them together. Right now I have a couple piece of puzzle, but I don't know the final result.
A cagey answer. Well, we're going to keep our eyes open for more from Normand Latourelle, the creator of Cavalia. Normand, thanks for being with us today.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.
And for every impresario, you need to have a star. And the star of Cavalia is definitely my next guest, Frederic Pignon, along with his wife, Magalie Delgado. This is The Horse Show. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD TV, and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention the horse show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention the horse show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975. EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
Well, Cavalia certainly wouldn't be Cavalia without the incredible horsemanship of the head equestrian. I'm not even sure that's his correct title. We'll find out in just a moment. Frederic Pignon. Frederic, welcome.
Thank you.
What is your official title?
Head trainer or horse director, or I don't know.
How long have you been with the show?
So we started a long time ago with Norma at the beginning. I think we met him like 6 years ago. And then we start to have this idea to do this show because he has the idea. And we wanted to do this because it's like a very nice project for us. And we start really the show like 1 year and a half ago, I think, in Quebec, and it's doing very good. We have it's successful. Every town we are going, it's very interesting, and the reaction is very interesting to see.
Is it a different reaction than you expected?
Yes, because I thought at the beginning the people will be happy to see the beauty, but more than this, they are very deeply touched by what they see, I think. And now I can realize that it's maybe more than a horse show, but it's something else, like a message of peace or something like that. You know?
Well, we know that the horse reaches down and touches a very special part of all of us. I mean, that we all know that, or we wouldn't be involved with them the way we are. And certainly your show brings that out. Just some of the statistics regarding the show. How many different breeds of horses are there in the show?
We have 5 different, I think. There is Arabian horses, Percheron, Belgium, Lusitano. We have like 18 Lusitano, and quarter horses.
2 questions. First question, how many horses are featured in the show? And the second question would be, how many horses do you travel with?
Oh, we travel with 40 horses now. And on the show, 37. So almost all the horses on the show. But they are not doing every night the same thing. So sometimes they are doing very easy things, and sometimes it's more difficult just to change to they are not getting boring every night.
How many stallions versus geldings versus mares?
22 stallions, because we have 3 new ones, and all the other ones are gelding. We have no mares at all. It could be more difficult to have so much stallion together and mares.
Well, even without mares there, you would think that the stallions might sometimes become a little aggressive with one another. Does that ever present a problem?
Oh, yes, it's very difficult to work with so much stallion together. Even they are very good trained and educated, but I think it's to work with so much stallion together on liberty, it's like...
Well, it sounds like quite a challenge. I don't know if that's the word you're looking for, but quite a challenge to do that sort of thing. Not only stallions, but then at liberty on top of that. Is every night different?
Yes, it's every night it's improvisation. I just play with what's happened. I know and they know more or less the routine we have, but every day I have to play with the idea they have on the moment. For example, sometimes they don't want to play at all, so I have to make them play and say, okay, come on, go to play. And sometimes they are playing too much. I say, oh, easy, because they are playing together and fighting. So every night I have something else, something different.
Have you ever had what we would call wrecks, where somebody got hurt or something happened, you know, a part of the set got knocked down or something happened out of the ordinary? Does that ever happen with the show?
Not so much, because I think I know well my horses and they know well me, so and they respect me a lot, so
But you're just one of the performers out there. There's lots of other horses and other riders out there, and sometimes they're racing across the stage. Sometimes they're doing some... It's not all at liberty. There's a lot of things that go on during the course of this show.
Yes, with the other one, the other acts and other acrobats and horses, for example, choke riding can be dangerous, but because I think we try to do it easier every day. So when we train, we never train on the canter like you see on the show. On the show, it's the faster they are going. And
so you train slow in order to have speed for the performance.
Yeah, to make sure everything is very... everybody know where he has to be and to make sure it's very safely. So we have sometimes injury because some acrobats, they can have problem with the muscle, but not so much with, we have no horses kicking, or all the horses are good and well, so we don't have so much problem.
You mentioned the trick riding, which of course was very, very fast, individual riders. The thing that probably I personally found the most exciting was the Roman riding. Right. And the actual jumping that was being done with the Roman riding. That seems like it was right on the edge, like anything could have happened. Has anybody ever fallen off when they did that?
Yes, sometimes. Not so much, because it's a little bit the same. We are playing... This is dangerous, but we are working so much, and all the riders are working so much every day to make sure they are know and control everything they do. It seems very dangerous, but it's we try to control the more we can everything we do.
How do you select the horses that are in the show?
So, for example, for Roman riding or truck riding, I like to work with quarter horses because it's exactly the type of horse I'm looking for that, because they are fast enough, they are very calm and quiet very quickly. They are very smart and they understand very quickly what we have to do, what we want. And we chose horses very gentle with the people, because if something bad happens, for example, in Roman riding, the rider can fail on the horses or between the two horses, and the horses then never have to kick or push the rider at the opposite. They have to respect him and say, okay, oops, he fell down, so we have to slow down, and they understand very good this, so it's very easy to work with them.
So quarter horses are your favorite for that type of thing. How do you select the performers, the humans that are in the show?
We do a lot of addition for that, and so what we are looking for the people, it's first personal ability to do what they used to do. I mean, the professionalism. What is difficult, I think, and we are really looking for, it's people with a real respect for the horses, and because it's all what the story about the show, it's this, the respect and the gentle work with horses, and it's not so easy to find people with this kind of respect. But and then they're working with us, they are getting much more relaxed and calm with the horses, and they see that to have good results, it to be patient and to be, so this is good to have people with a very open mind for that.
I believe this is sort of a family affair for you. Your wife is also in the act.
Yes, my wife and her sister are working with me, and it's like a big family. We are touring together, and everybody has a fun together. It's very, very interesting to see how we can be very friend at the end.
About 160 people, is that what I heard Norman say?
Yes, it's a lot of people, yeah.
That's a small city. And you come into a place like this, you really don't know anybody else. Any personality conflicts ever occur within this group of 160 people?
Oh, yes, sometimes, like in every groups, but it's part of the life.
A little bit about your philosophy of horsemanship. When I see you working with these, I believe they're Lusitanos, the white horses that you're working with at Liberty out there, it was very reminiscent of what we see at Liberty work in what we call natural horsemanship in America, and I know that's spreading to other parts of the world. Is that something that you studied, or this just kind of emerged as a natural thing for you, that you would have this same kind of empathetic and kind of psychological technique with these horses?
Yeah, I think it's my father who gave me this philosophy at the beginning, and so for me it's very natural to be like this with horses, and this means to have respect, to play with them, because we know, like I was playing with my dog, I play with my horses, and this was since a long time, since I'm children, it's natural for me. When I arrive in the classical world of horses, when I was speaking to my horses, the people were looking at me like if I was a crazy boy. Now I'm normal because a lot of people are doing this, and now a lot of people encourage this.
I have one last question for you. I know you need to go and get ready for your performance. You're out there running around barefoot. How do you keep from getting stepped on or getting hurt doing that?
I have to run fast sometimes.
You do run very fast. I was going to compliment you on that. And you're not a small guy. You're a tall, lean guy, but you really move quickly.
Yeah, I have. I think I have no choice, but I know well my horses, and I know exactly where they will put the foot. So it's now it's like normal for me, but I have to be careful every day.
Have you ever gotten stepped on?
Not never for now, but I have to touch wood now because I don't want this.
I don't want to jinx it. Well, hopefully tonight won't be the night. My guest has been Frederic Pignon, the head trainer of Cavalia. Frederic, thanks so much for being with us today.
Thank you very much.
You know, folks, I fear in spite of all our talk, you probably still don't have a real sense for what Cavalia is all about. You honestly couldn't until you saw it, I don't think. But they have a great website, cavalia.net, CAVALIA.net, and you can learn more there. Special thanks to Norman Latourelle, Frederic Pignon, and also to Elizabeth McCall, who handles publicity for them and has done such a nice job and got us involved in this. So thanks to that whole troop. I want to remind you about my website, folks, thehorseshow.com. We're updating it every single week. That is the place if you want to listen to past editions of The Horse Show on radio, find a radio station carrying our program, find out what's coming up on TV this week on RFD-TV, buy my books, find out where I'm going to be. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.